We are so thankful to be here, to be a part of you. You sent us about 110 cards in the mail, all just personally, with your personal messages on there for us. We just want to personally say thank you for all of that encouragement. We had a lot of people come over to our house this past Friday morning as we closed our new home in Powder Springs. And so you were there with them in spirit. And so we just want to say thank you for all that you are doing for our family. We just feel so blessed that we are finally home. And we're just so thankful for all that God is doing. And I want to remind you, as we are going through together this series on 21 days of prayer, I can't think of anything that is more important been starting a new season as we pray together, because we want not what we can do, but what God can do. Amen. And we want to see God move in our church in only the way that He can. I do want to remind you that our first part of the series, our first message together on 21 days of prayer, was that we are to be praying for God's presence in our church. Because if God is not present, it does not matter. If God does not move, it does not matter. We talked about 1 Kings chapter 8 together. We talked about the importance, if you remember, of preparing for the presence of God, recognizing the presence of God, repenting from our sin because of the presence of God, blessing others because of His presence, blessing us, and just simply enjoying the presence of God together. We came and prayed over our church for the presence of God. And then last Sunday, our second part of the series, we talked about the power, praying for the power of Christ in us, in our Christian lives, but also in our church. If you remember, we talked about that we would be praying for our family, praying for our church family, praying for our immediate families, our local families, in our home, so that God's power would be in us. We talked about the importance of praying for our fervor. Because if you want to desire God more, that desire does not come within you. It comes from God Himself. He's the one that gives us the desire for Him. And then we talked about our future, praying for our future. Now to Him who is far more abundantly able to do more than we could ever ask or think, to Him be glory through Christ in the church, through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 21. We believe that. And so we're praying for our future here at First Baptist. Because I can't wait to watch how God is going to use you. And how God's going to use you to reach people, to be able to come, to experience what you get to experience, to come for the same reason that you come. Because you believe that God speaks to you here, that He is present with you here, and that He is moving in your life here. So this morning, we're finishing out our series on 21 days of prayer, and this morning's sermon is simply this: praying for the presentation of the gospel in our community. Praying for the presentation of the gospel in our community. Why? Because the world today needs Jesus. Can I get an amen? The world today needs Jesus. The world today is lost without God. The world today is dying without God. The world today needs hope. The world today needs truth. The world today needs love, because all of those things are found in God alone. So this morning, I want to help us from John chapter 17. You can turn there in your Bibles. John chapter 17. I want to give you three prayers that you could be praying this week and the rest of your life, on how we could be praying that the gospel would be presented through us in our community. The first prayer, I'll go ahead and tell you real quick, the whole sermon. That way, if you need to go, you can go. For the whole sermon right here. Number one is that we would pray for the glorification of Christ. Number two, that we would pray for the sanctification of our church. And number three, we would pray for the justification of our community, or the salvation of our community. Let's jump in. Let's dive in. Number one, here we go. Pray, I want to encourage us together to be praying for the glorification of Christ. Here's what Jesus said in John 17. This is His high priestly prayer when priests of the Old Testament would go into the temple to pray. This is Jesus going in, and this is Jesus praying for us. This is the high priestly prayer. This is the longest recorded prayer of all of Scripture, of the New Testament. John 17:1, Jesus said this. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven. In other words, he was praying. By the way, if Jesus, the Son of God, was a man of prayer, how much more do we need to be people of prayer? Jesus, God himself, a man of prayer, how much more so do we need to be a people of prayer? Jesus said, Father, the hour has come. So glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Jesus said, the hour has come. What hour is he talking about? Well, this is right before Jesus is going to his suffering, before he's going to his crucifixion, before he's going to his burial, before he's going to his resurrection. Notice that Jesus is already talking about his glory. Do you realize in the Christian life you are not alone? That suffering almost always comes before blessing. If you are going through a time of suffering in your life, it's because that God is setting you up for a blessing to come. God often takes us through suffering because it is the pattern of the gospel. And when we go through suffering, we appreciate and we enjoy the blessings all the more. Suffering is what focuses our attention on God. Blessing is what focuses our praise on God. Jesus was about to go through this intense suffering, but he knew that it was the suffering that was going to bring him to glory. And I love what Jesus prayed. Jesus prayed to his Father. He said, Father, would you glorify me? Why? So that I may glorify you. It's always fascinating to me throughout the Scriptures that it seems like the Trinity are always pointing to one another. You ever seen that meme or that GIF where like Batman, Spider-Man, and Superman are all pointing at each other, right? It's a little bit like what the Trinity does. They're all seeking to glorify one another. In other words, you even get to see humility within the Trinity. In 1 John 16:14, Jesus said that the Spirit will come and the Spirit of God will glorify me. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9 through 11, it says that every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. In other words, if you want to glorify God, one of the greatest ways is to bow on your knees in saying, Jesus, you are the Lord of my life. To confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. The Bible says that when we glorify Jesus, we are glorifying the Father. Why? Because Jesus, you can write this down, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 says that he is the mediator between God and man. So if you have God, divinity, and man, humanity, and the only way to connect the two, the only way that we can get to God is through the God-man, Jesus Christ. The only way that man can get to God is through the God-man, Jesus Christ, the middleman, our mediator, 1 Timothy 2, verse 5 says. Why? Because God loves it when his Son is glorified. The Father loves it. I remember back in 1996, I was a senior in high school, and that was my senior basketball season. We got to experience winning the state championship in high school basketball there in Alabama in our conference. And so I can remember that game, and I remember just, it was one of the greatest highlights, just memories of my life, just celebrating, right, with this championship that we had just won. We were the victors, and I remember loving it so much that I wanted to go back and watch the video that my dad taped. Now, for all of you under the age of 40, taped is actually this device. You would use a camcorder, and you would put a box in it called a tape. Can I get an amen? And you would hold the camcorder on your shoulder. There was none of this with your phone or this. It was holding a camcorder on your shoulder, videotaping something. If you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry about it. So my dad, camcorder, videoing the whole thing. I popped the tape in what is called a VCR. And so I popped the tape in the VCR, and I turned it on, and I was watching the whole game. And at the end of the game, when the clock ticked down to zero. And the crowd went wild as we won the state championship. I heard one voice over the rest of the arena, and it was my dad shouting and cheering and celebrating because his son had just been a part of a state championship basketball game. He was so proud of his boy. I want you to know that God the Father is so proud of his boy, Jesus. God the Father loves it when his son is glorified in our lives. He loves it when Jesus is worshiped. He loves it when Jesus is praised. He loves it when Jesus is exalted. He loves it when Jesus is witnessed. He loves it when Jesus is prayed to. He loves it when Jesus' name is on our lips. He loves it when we live our lives for Jesus. Can I ask you a question? Is the mission of your life the glory of Jesus Christ? Is your greatest desire, your greatest passion, and your greatest joy to bring glory to Jesus in your life? So what do we do with this prayer? How do we emulate this? Because let's be honest, we're sinners. I'm a sinner. My sin wants the glory. My sin wants the fame. My sin wants the credit. Don't look at me all spiritual, so does yours. You want the same thing that I want in my sin, in our flesh. And isn't it interesting that often in life we have this ambition to become greater? We have this ambition to be glorified. We have this ambition maybe for more influence. Maybe for more impact in your life. Maybe you want to be able to impress more people. I love how Jesus prayed it, and I believe he gave us a model for this prayer. God, if you want to glorify me, I will take that glory and I will give it all to you. If you want to glorify me, I will take it all and I will glorify you. In other words, God, only give me the glory in life that I will give you the glory with. Only give me the glory in life that I will give you the glory with. I think that there is something about the prayer of Jabez that resonates with us in Scripture. What did Jabez pray? He said, God, would you bless me? Would your hand be upon me? And would you enlarge my territory? Would you bless me? What is he asking for? Influence. What is he asking for? Impact. And I believe that it is perfectly appropriate for us to say, God, would you do such a work in my life so that I can point others to you? We are praying for the glorification of Jesus in our life. Jesus, would you be glorified in me? Jesus, would you have an impact through me? Jesus, would you use me to present the gospel to the lost, so that others can know you and glorify you like I know you and glorify you? There are three ways we see here very quickly, just here in this, the following verses, ways that we can glorify Jesus. We can offer, if you're writing this down, the verse will be on the screen. We can offer eternal life to others. Verse 2, offering eternal life to others. Since you have given him authority, Jesus said, over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. One way you can glorify Jesus is by simply presenting the gospel to others. Can I just remind you, you can't save them? Can I just remind you that you can't make the decision for them? One of the ways that Satan loves to stop us from sharing the gospel the most is by whenever we share, when people don't get saved, we feel like a failure. You are not a failure when you share the gospel and they don't get saved. It is a success because you have been obedient. And statistics tell us that typically people need to hear the gospel 7 times statistically before they get saved. So don't think you need to ask somebody, have you heard the gospel 6 times yet? Because I want to be the 7th time, right? I want to lead everybody to Jesus. No, the success is when we're faithful. And we let God do the work. It says in verse 3, Jesus said, and this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. What is the joy here? The joy, how do we glorify Jesus, is just enjoying our relationship with him. And also how you can glorify Jesus in verse 4, Jesus said, I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. How can you glorify Jesus in your life? By accomplishing the work that Jesus gave you to do. The mission that Jesus put you on. We need to be a church that prays for the glory of Jesus in our church. It is not about us. It is not about our name. It is not all about our church name, our brand, our logo. It is not about our church being the most talked about church in the country. It is not about any fame that our church can get. It is about the glorification of God's Son, Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen? That is why we're here, and we pray for that. Number two, we need to be praying for the sanctification of our church. If we want to be presenting the gospel in the community, we need to be praying for the sanctification of our church. Let me explain. Verse 8 says this. Jesus said, for I have given them the words. Everybody say word. Jesus said, I've given them the words that you gave me, that they received them, and they have come to know in truth that I came from you, and that they have believed that you sent me. What is sanctification? Listen to me. A lot of times I think we just call sanctification spiritual growth or becoming a better Christian or being more obedient or being more worshipful. While all of those things are true, what is sanctification? It's a big word we don't use a lot in our life, but it's in the Bible, so we need to know what it is. Sanctification means this, and you can write this down. Sanctification means to be made holy. To be made holy. What does it mean to be made holy? You can draw another arrow, and it's simply this: to be set apart. To be set apart for the mission of God. In other words, hear me. What is sanctification in its simplest form? Listen to me. It is the likeness and the image of Jesus in you. It is growing in the likeness in the image of Jesus in your life. The Bible tells us that there is one way that we can grow, one surefire way that we can grow in the likeness in the image of Jesus, and it is this: to simply spend time with him. To simply spend time with Jesus. We get in such a rush, we get in such a hurry, we get so busy that we forget the most important part of my life is the time that I personally spend with Jesus. With the Word of God in front of me. Times that I'm on my knees in prayer on a daily basis. With a cup of the Holy Spirit, a cup of coffee right beside me. Can I get an amen? The time that Jesus drinks coffee with me every morning, I believe it. The time that we spend with Jesus. That is how we are sanctified. That's how we grow in his image. You can write down Romans chapter 8, 29. It says that we are predestined to be conformed to the likeness of Jesus. Everyone in here might have a different definition of predestination, and that's okay. Because the point is not what it is. The point is who we are predestined to. We're predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus. Colossians 3, 10 says that we are being renewed in the image of our Creator. That's what the Holy Spirit of God is doing in us. Why? Because listen to me, when we are sanctified in Jesus Christ and we become like him, then we can't help but present the gospel to the lost and dying world around us. We can't help it. Why? Because Jesus himself is the ultimate missionary. Jesus himself is the one who came down out of heaven, came to our home. He came to example and model for us what it looks like to live for God. And Jesus is the only one who died and who rose from the dead to seal the gospel salvation in our life. Jesus is the ultimate missionary. So listen to me. If you ever get convicted like I do, that you're not sharing your faith as you should. The point is not to buckle down and double down and say, I'm going to do it today. Instead, it's Jesus. I need to spend time with you so that you do it through me today. So that you give me your eyes. You give me your words. You give me your passion. You give me your urgency. And I think so many church members think, I don't know how. I think so many people say, Pastor Chip, so many Christians would say, Pastor Chip, I just don't know how. Can I just encourage you with an illustration that the Lord has given me? Imagine that you were awarded a trip. Maybe you won a trip online and you got to go to Bora Bora, right? And you got to go to an overwater bungalow in Bora Bora. You got to go on the ultimate dream vacation. And while you were there, they gave you the whole timeshare spiel. And you were entered into a drawing, and you won another trip, and you could take whatever person or whatever family you wanted to go with you. Now, let me tell you what you would not do with that timeshare person. You would not look at them, and you would not say, man, that is awesome. Thank you so much for the free trip for me, the free trip for my friend, or the free trip for the family that I get to bring. Could you take me through a 12-week seminar class on how I can invite someone else to come with me to Bora Bora? Because what I really need is a workbook. Because I need to make this presentation sweet, right? And so if you could give me some fill-in-the-blanks and just give me some tips and some pointers, how I can present this to them that they could go on this amazing vacation with me. Now listen, I believe in evangelism training. I absolutely believe in that without a doubt. But I just want to give you some comfort this morning. Look at me and listen. If you believe the gospel and if you have given your life to Jesus, then you already know enough to share the gospel with someone so that they can give their life to Jesus. You already know enough. You just give them what you've got. You just walk them through what someone walked you through. You just present to them what you believe. Jesus died so you can be forgiven of your sin. Jesus rose so that you can believe in him and you can be saved. We already know enough. I see here in this passage four steps in growing in our sanctification in order to present the gospel. We already talked about verse 8, experiencing salvation. Look at verse 11. The second part of verse 11, Jesus said, Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. Jesus said, just as God, my Father, you and I are one, he said, I want to make them one. Jesus makes us one with him, but also he makes us one with one another. That's why we're taking the Lord's Supper this morning. Because the Lord's Supper is the sign that Jesus has given us to say that I believe that I am one with him. And I believe that I am one with my brothers and sisters in Jesus. That's why we do things like connection groups and Bible studies and Sunday school. And we do all these things. We got to sit down with other Christians. You know why? So that you know that you're not crazy. It's not just you. You're not the only one hurting. You're not the only one suffering. You're not the only one with needs. You're not the only one with prayer requests. You're not the only one with pain. You're not the only one with questions. You're not the only one that experiences doubt. You are not alone. We need to sit down with one another and be real with one another and transparent with one another so that we can minister to one another. Verse 17, Jesus said, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. What are we sanctified in? We're made holy in the word of God. We need the word of God on Sunday mornings. Preach to us. We need the word of God every single day imparted to us from Jesus himself. In verse 18, Jesus said, Father, as you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. Do you know who you are? You are those who are sent by Jesus. You're sent. Jesus looks at you and he loves you. And he empowers you, and you are not alone as you go into the community and you share the gospel. The name with Jesus, name of Jesus, your testimony, your story, you're not alone. Why? Because Jesus is the one who is with you. And Jesus is the one who wants to save them even more so than you want them to be saved. Jesus is with you. He has sent us on a mission. I can remember going with my wife on a mission trip to Ireland right after we were married. And we were with a group of people, and we would do all these presentations on the street, whether singing a song or doing some type of drama or play. And Ireland is just, it's a very different country if you've ever been there. Religiously, the Reformation skipped Ireland. All it is the Irish Catholic faith. And so much of the country hates religion because it is so legalistic and moralistic there through the church. And so whenever we do a street performance to gather a crowd, someone would grab a microphone and share that we're from America, from such and such a church, and we would share the gospel, and people would literally start running in the other direction. The same people who were listening would start saying words that were inappropriate in our direction. The same people who were clapping seconds before would start spitting in our direction. And here's what's amazing that would happen. We would get back to the place we were staying. The group would get back together. We would share stories of what we experienced that day. We would pray for all of the people that we came in contact with. We would search the scriptures. How can we make more of an impact? Holy Spirit, would you please do a work? We would get deeper into our devotions. We would get more desperate for God. We would be in fellowship together so that we could go out the next day and we could do it again. And that's why it's so important that we are one with one another, because we are on this mission together and we're not crazy. It's exactly what Jesus has sent us to do. And number three, quickly, and I'm done, pray for the justification or the salvation of our community. Verse 20 says this. Jesus said, I do not ask for these only. He said, but Father, I also ask for those who will believe in me through their word. Jesus didn't just pray for the church. He prayed for the community. He didn't just pray for believers, he prayed for unbelievers. He didn't just pray for the saved, he prayed for the lost. And we need to do the same. We need to pray for one another. But we need to pray for these empty seats, that God would use us to fill them with people who need him. And God places us in circles, in conversations, in influence, in relationships, on a daily basis, that if we just get the conversation started, then he will roll it through us, and he will flow through us, and it'll be amazing how people will start to ask questions, because the Bible says that we just need to be ready to be prepared to share the hope that has lied within us, that lies within us because of people who need what we have. I have a friend back in Virginia where we lived last. His name is DJ, and DJ came up to me and said, Pastor Chip, you'll never believe what happened. He said, this past Father's Day, my family gave me one of these DNA kits where you take blood and you send it in, you kind of see if you have other family members and learn things about yourself all around the world. And so he did the test and he sent it in and he got back the results and he found out that he had a half-brother he had never knew of. He got to know his half-brother. His half-brother called him one day and he said, DJ, it's time. Are you sitting down? DJ said, yeah, why? And he said, DJ, I need you to know that the man whom you have always called your dad, the man who raised you, the man that you were named after, is not your real father. DJ gets a hold of his mom. His mom had kept the secret for over 30 years. And sure enough, DJ's dad was not his real father. And DJ's looking at me smiling. I'm like, DJ, do you need counseling? Because we have great counselors that could really, this is some deep, deep stuff, man. And he looked at me and he just kind of chuckled and he said, Pastor Chip, this doesn't change a thing. He said, my dad will always be my dad. He said, Pastor Chip, He said, here's the deal. God is ultimately my father. God's my father, and so he's my true identity. So the psalmist said that I cannot be shaken. He said, the way I see it is, God has just now given me more family members that I didn't know of that I get to share the gospel with. Man, I want the heart of DJ. That is unbelievable that he sees it as that type of opportunity. How do we pray? How do we pray for our community? What is our motivation for their salvation? Well, I think I see three quick motivations in God's word for our presentation of the gospel in our community. Look at verse 21. Verse 21, and we'll be done. Verse 21 says this, that they, Jesus said, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I am in you, that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. A motivation, listen, to present the gospel for people to be saved is this, that they may be one with us as we are one in Christ, that they get to experience the oneness that we get to experience. Verse 22, he said, the glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one even as we are one. He said it again. What is the second motivation for us to present the gospel? Simply this, that they would get to experience the glory of Jesus like we get to experience the glory of Jesus. They have no idea what it feels like to be able to give Jesus glory. And the glory that he shares with us, the excitement, the celebration that he shares with us. In verse 23, Jesus said, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one. Listen. So that the world may know, Jesus said, Father, that you sent me and that you loved them. Jesus said that you love them even as you love me. Did you know that God loves you as much as he loves Jesus? And that God loves them as much as he loves you? And Jesus has sent us on mission into the world that we can just very simply, listen to me, give them what has been given to us. And you just get to tell your story, to share your testimony. The Bible says that it is the name of Jesus by which people are saved. Often when you just drop his name, we all know this, it's a conversation topic. People like to discuss the name of Jesus, amen? And you never know how the Holy Spirit will guide and direct that conversation because the Holy Spirit loves to glorify Jesus. I'm going to ask us all to bow our heads and close our eyes in this time. Maybe this morning you're here and you're like me, and you just need God to, as this is true of all of us, that God just needs to grow us in terms of sharing the gospel with whom we come in contact with. Who is the one name that God is laying on your heart right now? Who's that one face, you may not even know their name, that God is putting on your heart to share the gospel of Jesus with this week? Don't let them go. Don't let this week get by you. Trust God in the way that he wants to work and he wants to move. And just simply talk about your story. Talk about Jesus. And watch what he wants to do through you. Maybe you're here this morning and you need to give your life to Jesus first. Maybe you know that you've not fully given it over to him like he rightly deserves, and that he deserves the glory from your life. You can pray right here, right now. Receive him as the Lord of your life. I can't pray this prayer for you. I'm not asking you just to repeat a prayer after me, but I want to encourage you that you can pray a prayer like this from your own words and your own heart. You can say, God, I believe in Jesus. I want to give him the glory of my life. tired of wanting all the glory for myself. I want to give all the glory to Him. I believe that Jesus died for my sin. And I ask Him to forgive me of all of my sin. I want to turn from my sin and live my life for Him. Forgive me, God, I pray. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I believe that He's alive. I believe that He's real, and I want Him in me. And so, God, I pray that You would save me. You can say with your own words and your own heart, I confess Him that Jesus is the Lord of my life, calling Him to be the Lord of your life. I believe that He rose from the dead, and I'm asking You to save me. And the Bible says that He will. He promises to save you. Heavenly Father, we love You. And God, we just pray that our lives, that our church would bring glory to Your Son, Jesus Christ. God, we pray and we ask in Jesus' name, God, that You would give us influence, God, so that we could give Jesus glory. Father, we pray that You would sanctify us. God, You would make us holy. You would make us one. You would grow us in Christ's likeness, in His image. And God, as we become more like Christ, that we would be a missionary like Him. In Jesus, I pray for the salvation of our community. God, would You use us every day to live in such a way that someone could get saved? God, would You use our church as we are one with one another to reach our community with the gospel of Jesus Christ? We give You all the glory. We need You to accomplish Your work that You've given us. So we pray that You would fill us with Your Holy Spirit. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. During this time, we're going to take the Lord's Supper together because we are one with Him and one with one another. So I'm going to ask the deacons to come forward at this time. If John and Alan would come forward right now. And I just want to read a passage of Scripture from Luke chapter 22, verse 14, as they prepare. Jesus said that when the hour had come, it said that He reclined at tables and the apostles were with Him, and He said to them, listen to me, Jesus said, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I want you to know that Jesus earnestly desires for us to do this with Him and with one another. This pleases Jesus as we are one together. This is no ritual. This is not something we take lightly. This is not just a tradition. This is something that Jesus gives us that we get to enjoy together with Him and with one another. I want to remind you that this is for believers. This is for those who are saved in Christ, believing in the gospel, that you have been baptized, and that you are following Jesus. Jesus said that He earnestly desired to eat this with us. And listen, verse 16, He says, for I tell you, I love this. He said, I'm not going to eat of it again until it is all fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Jesus is fasting from the Lord's Supper until He comes back. And you know when He's going to take it with us for His first time again? At the marriage supper of the Lamb. But until then, Jesus gave us this, to remember His body that was sacrificed for us, His blood that was shed for us, that made us one with Him and one with one another. Deacons, you can distribute the elements. Thank you.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I'll stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in hell, this babe, this gift. His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, sin's curse had lost its grip. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
Chairman of Deacons, John is going to lead us in prayer before we take the bread together.
May we pray. Dear Lord, we are a thankful people. Thankful for the Son, Jesus Christ. We're thankful for the salvation that we have through our belief in Him. And dear Lord, I pray that You would guide us as we take of the bread. We thank You for the crucifixion, dear Lord, but without the resurrection, it's meaningless. We thank You for the raised Son of Jesus Christ. We thank You, dear Lord, for Your blessing us. We thank You for that love, and help us be mindful of the love that You have for us, to help us to show others that same love. For it's in Your name that I pray. Amen.
Verse 19 says, and He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it, and He gave it to them, saying, this is My body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me. Ask our deacon chairman-elect, Alan Martin, if he would come and pray over the cup.
Let's pray. Father, we come to Your throne this morning with reverent hearts, thankful hearts, thankful for all the blessings that You have bestowed upon us already. Father, we are Your people. We are gathered together today at Your table. As John said, we are so thankful for the body that was broken for us to cover those sins. And now, Father, as we take of the cup, we pray Your blessing upon each soul that will partake of that blood representation, Father, that covered all of our sins for now and all time. Father, we pray Your blessing upon each household represented here, Father, as they partake. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Verse 20 says, and likewise, the cup after they had eaten, Jesus said, this is the cup that is poured out for you. This is the new covenant in my blood. Heavenly Father, what an honor it is to take the Lord's Supper for the glory of Jesus. Thank you for making us one with Jesus, one with you. Thank you for making us one with one another that we don't do life alone. Thank you for our church. Thank you that your Spirit is here in this church. And Father, we pray that you would continue to grow us and use us. In Jesus' name.